Namaste. This is Rajiv Malhotra from Princeton, New Jersey. I've lived in the United States for most of my life. I've lived here about 50 years. Very connected to India. I go there about four times a year, except nowadays, of course, it's not possible to go. I was raised in Delhi, went through St. Stephen's College, then came to the United States. First, pursuing a career in physics, then computer science. And then I worked in the corporate world and started my own companies. And in my early 40s, I decided to quit all that, exit all that, and start this kind of a career to understand our civilization, our culture, and give back. So full time, I run the Infinity Foundation, which I started. So here I am going to talk to you about one of the major areas of my work, which is a theory that I created called the U-turn theory. Now, U means that somebody starts, then they go on a journey somewhere, and then they come back. So the U-turn refers to how Westerners often come and study Indian culture, either physically in India, or they do a metaphorical journey, living in the United States, living in Europe. They go into the Indian territory mentally, and study Indian culture. Then they change their mind and they contextualize it as something Western or their own original idea. And they often reject the Indian source, their gurus, their paramparas, all of that. And then they come back and claim it as something original. They become big celebrities in the West. And then some of them really start denigrating the Indian source and even disown whatever they learned from India. This then gets exported back to India, and Indians lap it up as something kind of very originally Western or American or something like that, which they don't realize is actually of Indian origin. So this U-turn I've studied hundreds of these U-turns in areas like yoga becoming Christian yoga and Bharatanatyam becoming Christianized, and mind sciences, meditation, becoming turned into mind sciences. I've studied the effect in literature. Many, many famous Westerners have been U-turners, from people like Kant, very famous, Nietzsche, Hegel. More recently in the 20th century, people like Whitehead, people like Jung, people like, T.S. Eliot, famous people. So a lot of Western ideas are of Indian origin, but not acknowledged. A lot of the Western history ought to be rewritten because they attribute it to origins in Greece, but they don't attribute to the origins of the parts that came out of India. So this U-turn theory also is forcing people to correct the history of ideas, history of Europe. And then this is also going to change the history of India, because you see, the history of India is not just others coming in and invading and giving us things and changing us, but how Indian knowledge has been exported, how India, the history of India is also present in the history of Europe and the history of China and so on. So the U-turn theory has ramifications beyond just Indian history, in fact, it changes the whole idea of world history. I want to tell you how I started this, how it started, what the theory is, what are some major examples. You know, having lived in the United States, I am very active, even though I'm a technocrat, but I've always been very active in the culture, civilization front, particularly in what is called mind sciences in the United States. So I used to go to conferences in the 90s and find that what they are talking about is of Indian origin, but they're not saying it. So, for instance, a Stanford very famous person called Stephen LaBerge set up these institutes all over the world called Lucid Dreaming. And I knew that this is Yoga Nidra. So I confronted him. And privately, he said, yes, that he learned it from this guru. But publicly, he can't say it because it has to look scientific. And only when Westerners have made it scientific, it becomes scientific. But if he said he learned it from some Indian guru, nobody would believe it. He told me all this. Then I came across that transcendental meditation of Maharishi, Mahesh Yogi, had been appropriated by a Harvard man called Dr. Herb Benson. He's very old now. I just interviewed him. Actually, I have a video of my recent interview with him. He was this young man who came across this very new thing called meditation, which they did not know in American medicine and American, you know, philosophy and all that. And he found that there was a huge medical benefit of people meditating. So he studied and these meditators, these transcendental meditators, wrote one paper on it. Then he decided that he should not refer to TM, transcendental meditation, but call it his own. And he gave it the name relaxation response. And he said, replace om. Instead of saying om, 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 you say one, 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 one. So this way you can get the same kind of effect. And this way you can decontextualize it from the Indian source. Decontextualize, remove the Indian source. So he came up, he became very famous, and he's a big shot, one considered one of the pioneers in meditation, with no acknowledgement to Maharishi. Then I came across mindfulness meditation. John Kabat-Zinn in Massachusetts, credited as the pioneer of mindfulness meditation, but actually that is Vipassana. And in personal dialogues with him, he acknowledges that he actually learned this from Cuenca, and then he put it into medical use, found that it works, creates many solutions to many medical problems. He convinced the insurance companies that this should be covered as treatment. Lot of patents, lot of copyrights, huge industry called mindfulness, okay? But actually it is Vipassana. So like this, I was going on coming across many, many examples, and I found a certain pattern. There are certain parts of the pattern I want to explain. One part of the pattern is that the person who is the U-turner, who is appropriating, is not static in his relationship with India. In the beginning, he's immersed in the Indian knowledge. He's very loyal to it. He might even change his name. Some of these, the women, they have wearing saris and bindis. Some of the men, they have become a disciple of a swami. They are walking around in dhotis and so on, the hippies. So some of them are more formal. They continue their Western demeanor, and some of them become very Indianized. Okay, but the point is that they are in the first stage, they're very immersed in, and they're not afraid to acknowledge. Then I found that it changes over time as they become confident, and they want to plagiarize, or they want to market it. There's market value, or their peers in the Western countries tell them, why are you getting involved in all this stuff? Then they decontextualize, which means this is stage two, when the Indian context is removed, the guru is removed, the Indian Shastra is removed, the Indian cultural context is removed, the Indian history of this whole thing is removed, and it becomes kind of universal, okay? Universal knowledge that doesn't belong to anybody, okay? So for instance, a whole lot of ideas from Dharma are characterized as spiritual but not religious. Okay, sounds very nice, you know, spiritual but not religious. So all kind of ideas, vegetarianism, karma theory, the meditation, all sorts of great ideas from in the Indian traditions are recharacterized in the category of spiritual but not religious. This is stage two. Stage three is when it becomes recontextualized. So after decontextualizing, which means you remove the Indian context and you claim it's universal, now you recontextualize it, put it into your own context. So it becomes Christian yoga. Now it is Christian. It is not just universal. It is Christian yoga. Christian Bharatanatyam. So this way, Jung actually went to India. And in the 1930s, he was teaching Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. He was teaching Tantra. He came up, he was using words like Shakti, Kundalini, Mandala. He had all these terms in his vocabulary. And he was teaching all this. But when Jung died, his students, while writing about Jungian thought, removed the Indian influences. So the U-turn is sometimes not the same person. The person goes through certain part of the journey, and then their students in the parampara, their followers, people who read them, who are inspired by that, they take the journey further. Okay. So in Jung's case, he did not deny the Indian influence. He had his own issues and complex relationship with Indian thought. But then his students and biographers, they completely erased the Indian influences. So this is stage three, when it gets recontextualized as something Western. It could be Western science, like mind sciences. Very nice it sounds. But it's all meditation they've learned from Hindu yogis and Buddhist meditators and then recharacterize it as neuroscience and so on. So it's either a scientific framework that is given to it, or it is recharacterized as Christian, Judeo-Christian. Yeah, one of these two is found. That is stage three. So to go through this stage, one is the person is honestly immersed, learning as a student, as a disciple. Stage two is when he decontextualizes, he removes the Indian context. And stage three is when he puts it back into American history, European history, he attributes it to Plato or Jesus Christ or something like that. You know, that is stage three. Stage four, he starts actually hating the Indian culture because it is full of caste, it is primitive, they hate their women. So now he needs an excuse. And now when I ask these guys, why are you not attributing the Indian culture? If it were Greek, you would attribute it. I mean, obviously, if another Westerner created something and you are borrowing it, nothing wrong with borrowing, but you acknowledge the source. Otherwise, it's wrong. It's ethically wrong. They will tell me things like, oh, you know, we don't want to be associated with the caste system, with abusing people, abusing women. So now they come up with a good excuse for being a thief. Okay. So now this argument is foolish. It is wrong, flawed argument. It's like somebody comes to your house and he steals your jewelry. And then when you catch him and he can no longer deny it, then he starts saying things like, you know, you're not an honest man, you're a wicked person, it will look better on me than on you, it's better that I wear it, you know, I deserve it more. That's a silly argument. The point is that if they've taken something of Indian origin, they have to acknowledge it just like they would if they were promoting something of Judeo-Christian origin or Greek origin or anything like that. Yeah, it's because our people have not been vigilant. We have not been calling this out. We have not been out there on the front lines debating and arguing, which is a very controversial thing to do. I've been doing it for most of my adult life. Yeah. So I found so many cases of this sort. So this is stage four. When the source from which they got so much good stuff is actually accused. They're actually abusing the source while stealing from it. I also call it arson because, you know, an arsonist is somebody who steals from a bank and burns it. So on the one hand, he's taking the money from the bank. On the other hand, he's burning it down so that, you know, there's no evidence left. This business of stage four, typically they will destroy all evidence of their links with the guru, what they studied. They will stop using Sanskrit terms. They will come up with their own vocabulary because the source they don't want to acknowledge. And they want to actually show that that source is inferior. So the argument given is that we are more scientific people and we've taken some raw material from some ancient tribe and some primitive people and we've made it more successful. So this goes on. And then there is a stage five, which is very tragic. Stage five is all of this reformulated knowledge in Western garb is re-exported back to India. So Indians lap it up. Wow. Harold Gardner, multiple intelligences. But his theory of multiple intelligences is actually Sri Aurobindo's planes and parts of being. Because Sri Aurobindo explained that the being has many planes and many, many parts. And you got to educate all of these. It's not just one kind of education, but education is multidimensional. And he gave it the fancy name, multiple intelligences. So it's like because he gave that name, it is his, you know. And most people in India who invite such speakers don't know the Indian origin of these ideas. Now, Christian yoga has become very big. In the US, it's one of the most popular, rapidly spreading forms of yoga. In India, most of the Bharatnatyam and Indian classical dance studios and academy and, you know, places where they're teaching are teaching also along with the stories of Radha and Krishna and all. They are also teaching stories of Jesus and Mary doing the Indian dance, proper clothing, proper makeup. All of that is very authentic. Music is authentic, but the story has been changed. You see, so this is stage five when the U-turned, knowledge comes back to India and it is seen in India as though it's authentically Indian. Now, I'll give you a... Now, the problem is, what I found is that this is not... You can't blame the Westerners because the gurus are part of it. Gurus are confused about Western culture, don't know too much about it. they are thinking at a level which is paramarthika, the absolute, the transcendent, level. But they're talking to people who are in vyavarika, who are in the mundane world, who have egos. And even to the extent a guru knows about vyavarika, he knows the Indian vyavarika, the Indian cultural context. He doesn't understand the Western cultural context enough. In fact, the Western students are teaching him about the West. Okay, so that's not authentic knowledge. He has not done his own investigative work to understand Western knowledge enough to be able to say, here is how I have to teach Westerners. I have to first explain that they have to get out of this Western identity. They have to stop being this Westerner in order to get out of the Naam Roop, you see. So this is also a fault of the gurus, and also gurus are opportunistic. Gurus are opportunistic because, you know, they get money out of it, they get fame, they get foreign trips. If they're politically correct, it's better for their image. To do what I'm saying would be not necessarily very popular. It would be not very politically correct to do. So very few Indian gurus are willing to take that kind of a chance. Now, I found that besides spirituality, so many other domains have been the result of, have suffered from this kind of a U-turn. For instance, organic farming. Now, a British guy called Sir Albert Howard, 100 years ago, came to India to teach Indian. He was an agricultural scientist. He came to teach Indian farmers modern methods. And he wrote a very honest book, in which he says, actually, I'm learning from them. And he learned what later became known as organic farming, how you recycle things on the farm, how you rotate crops, how you mix crops, you know, all of this, how you keep the seeds for the best seeds. So all the techniques which had evolved in Indian agriculture for a very long time, he wrote a book on it. I have a copy of that book. He coined that idea as a kind of an Indian idea. He then started creating these farms to learn the method. He started creating these farms in India. And then he took this knowledge back to England and became quite a famous person. Then many years later, another Westerner, a German called Rudolf Steiner. Rudolf Steiner is credited as turning this organic farming knowledge into a very official, formalized body of work. But Rudolf Steiner was a theosophist. The theosophists were entirely informed by Indian knowledge. And he wrote so many books on the Vedas and on Indian itihas and, science and karma, reincarnation and Vedanta. He wrote a lot of books. And he was one of the leaders of this theosophy movement. But the head, Annie Besant, decided that the next leader should be J. Krishnamurti and not Rudolf Steiner. And this was a big blow to Rudolf Steiner's ego. So he quit the movement and started his own movement, taking all these knowledge, all these ideas, calling it his own. And so he's the one who's credited with creating this whole organic farming. So if you go and search organic farming, the history will say that Sir Albert Howard started it and Rudolf Steiner made it formal. There's no mention of India, maybe a little footnote somewhere. So this is how U-turns have damaged the history of science, the history of philosophy, the history of culture, ideas, and so on. Now, I can go on telling you about so many examples I have hundreds of examples in many different fields. So I'm writing these books for the last 30 years. I thought I'll write one book, but the number of examples is so huge that it will take several books. So volume one is called U-turn theory, which is the journey of individuals who go into this kind of either physical journey into India and back or kind of mental psychological journey while they are physically still in the West. So this is the U-turn theory model. It's a psychological model of a journey. And then the second volume is the theory of digestion. Digestion is not about any individual going on any journey, but the entire Western culture as a civilization digesting another civilization. The result of so many U-turns is that one civilization digests another. So for example, pagans got digested into Christianity. You should know that. lot of Christians went and U-turned and brought ideas from paganism. This idea of, mother and son, the iconography of Christianity is a pre-Christian pagan idea. The idea of, Christmas, the idea of Easter, so many of the symbols and rituals in Christianity are actually borrowed from the pagan. Now you might say, what's wrong? Well, what's wrong is that the pagans got destroyed. Their knowledge and culture got absorbed, but the paganism itself destroyed. Similarly, so much was taken from Africa, so much was taken from the Native Americans. Those people were perished, but their assets were taken. So the problem with digestion is that, I want to take your jewelry and your assets, but I want to kill you or put you aside and make you a slave or whatever. In some way, I want to disempower you. So this is the second volume, which is on digestion, with many, many examples and a whole theoretical framework on why digestion happens and how it happens. Then after these two books, which I want to get out by the end of this year, there are many, 5, 6, 7 volumes of big examples. For instance, Immanuel Kant, Nietzsche, Hegel, pioneering philosophers of the West, how they owe many of their ideas to Indian thought. Whitehead, pioneering philosopher, psychology, so much he did in psychology, so many of his ideas came from India. William James at Harvard, who hosted Vivekananda in the late 1800s, considered the pioneer of modern psychology. Actually, that's not true. He picked a lot of ideas from Vivekananda. He also picked ideas from Buddhism. So in this way, I'm looking at leading American thought systems, cultural systems, and leading thinkers, some of the greatest thinkers. So this way, I'm figuring out where these ideas have come from in order to give proper credit to the Indian thought. So by the end of 2021, my goal is to have like 7-8 volumes of this, 2 volumes with theory and many, many volumes with different examples of how people do U-turns, how they digest, how our people don't know. So I'll give you a very simple tragedy. Right now, you might think this new government solving all these problems. They're not solving all these problems. There's not a big dent in the education system. This whole kind of thing has not been given enough importance. A major example is the Indian Council of Social Science Research, which is part of HRD Ministry. Okay, ICSSR. They are the ones who give all the grants and they fund social sciences. So when they are funding, they decide what social science should be taught in India, who gets the research and so on. I have gone so many times and made presentations and given proposals and so on to study the Indian social sciences and the harm being caused by the study of left-wing. Most of the imported social sciences in India are all left-wing and there's hardly any Indian model being taught. And the tragedy is, they want me to do a study if I want a grant or if I want my team of young scholars to be sponsored by the government, because I don't need anything for myself, but I do want to work for my team and make sure that they get sponsored. If I want that, they will say that the proposal has to follow the established Western social science methodology. Now, this is very ulta. It's completely opposite. If the idea is to topple that system and replace it with our thinking, then why am I required to use their way of thinking? Okay, that's a very unfair thing. So this is, I could go on. I have many. I want you to follow me on Instagram, Infinity Foundation Official. Infinity Foundation Official. We will post links to many of my YouTubes, many things I've done. I have about 1,000 YouTubes. A lot of talk on many of such things. I can give you a lot more information. If you want to join, if you want to make this part of your life, this kind of pursuit, it'll be very exciting to have young people. So please follow Infinity Foundation Official on Instagram. And also on YouTube, I have Rajiv Malhotra Official. I have that. You can join that also. And there we can keep in touch. Now, I think I have a few minutes left and I can take some questions. I can go on talking for a very long time, but if there are questions, I can I'll be happy to take questions. So give me your questions, and I will answer. Okay. So there are a lot of comments, but I also want there is one. Sachin Trivedi says, my journey has started watching YouTube and reading books. Excellent. So I hope you will also watch some of these. Bisht N says, resistance to change is India's specialty. Yeah, I mean, India is resistance to change was not so all the time. Because, you know, if you look at our tradition of their changes were happening all the time. So somebody is saying, please share the name of the book by the British author. Okay, I will put that up on my page. How do we start our own individual research? So contact us, and we have many research projects. We have many research projects, and you know, if you are hardworking person, not emotional type, but very analytical, scientific kind of person, then you know, such people can be utilized by us. Somebody's asking, Breaking India online course, Pratik KKK 22. Okay, so Breaking India, which is a book of mine, published by Amaryllis and Panjul, that book has turned into an e-learning course. There is already an online course we just started. So if you go to one of our websites, you know, you could go to www.rajivmalhotra.com or infinityfoundation.com, and you could send a note. We will tell you, asking how to join. We can teach you how to join. We also have a discussion Google group with a few thousand members in it, and they're discussing all these ideas and all the work that we are doing. So if you want to join our conversation, if you want to learn about our courses, read and understand our books, you can contact us through the rajivmalhotra.com or infinityfoundation.com website and say contact and send a message. And we'll forward it to the right person. They'll make you a member of one of our Google groups where serious conversations are happening. And so that way you can be privy to all our work. But the Breaking India book is a course right now. I think it's 9 lessons or something like that. So now there's a question, what should be India's approach towards China as a friend or enemy? See, China, okay, now it's a different topic, but I'm happy to cover it. China is going to be the biggest threat to India, not because China will invade us, but they will arm Pakistan. China has got huge amount of technology, a huge edge over Indian manufactured technology. They are trying to come to par with American technology. They're catching up very rapidly. They have all the robots and the drones and all these kind of things. And because they are manufacturing it internally, indigenously, their price is very low. India has to go and buy at a huge cost. We have to buy foreign weapons to protect ourselves, and China is manufacturing it at a very low cost internally. So they're going to supply this to their colonies like Pakistan. And so the danger is going to be not Pakistan's own weapons, but the Chinese weapons fired by Pakistanis. So this, I think, is my feeling on the role of China in India's future. Somebody is saying, how to eliminate ego among Indic intellectuals. So this is a very important question. Very important question. I talked about the U-turn that Westerners have. Their ego does not allow them to acknowledge Indian contributions. I'm also finding U-turns within the Indian intellectuals. A lot of them have read these ideas that are developed, not done the tapasya, not done the research, not really internalized it, don't understand it fully, but they understand a little bit, and they start writing blogs and starting their own YouTube channel, going around various events and conclaves and lit fests and whatnot, becoming a big speaker. So all of a sudden, they are the ones digesting. So our people, instead of expanding the research, instead of helping in more research, often they are basically robbing each other's research and claiming it as their own. So this kind of a U-turn or digestion internally is very dangerous. So this is a serious problem we are having. which prevents us from developing a school of thought. To develop a school of thought, you must respect the sources, and you must then add on to those sources with your own effort and hard work. Okay. How can institutions like Arya Samaj be of help? See, I mean, any institution can be of help if it follows this. A good question, RK0174, is Sanskrit non-translatables. Now, I did not talk about my books. One of my books is on Sanskrit non-translatables. It's also coming out this year, by the way. It's finished. It's ready. We have 50 videos we are editing so that when the book comes out, there will also be videos for various chapters. Sanskrit non-translatables is this idea that certain words in Sanskrit should be used as originally in Sanskrit only. We should not translate them. Like, you know, Atma cannot be soul, the meaning changes. You know, Shakti cannot be energy, meaning changes. So there are certain words that should be preserved, and you should make them part of the English language. Bring them out as when you're speaking English, you should use that word, the Sanskrit word. So this book is giving you 54 examples of Sanskrit non-translatables and a whole theory on why you should use them. This will also be coming out. Another question is long-term plans with intellectual Kshatriya. So, you know, what we need are enough critical mass of intellectual Kshatriyas. We have intellectualkshatriya.com where you can go read articles and submit your own article, okay, and become an intellectual Kshatriya. Take my courses, my e-learning course on Breaking India. That's a very important requirement, prerequisite to be an intellectual Kshatriya. So those who have, when we have enough people who have done this, we want to organize them. We want to start having monthly Google Hangouts I want to do with them. And a few times a year in India, I would like to hold actual physical events where they can come. And we can create projects. So we have to be not emotional Kshatriyas, intellectual Kshatriyas, which means that, you know, firstly, you have to think bigger than yourself. And you have to be willing to stick your neck out. You have to be willing to come out of your comfort zone. And you have to be willing to be selfless. You have to be willing to do a lot of tapasya for a long time and not quick. How do I make myself important and famous? So that's the path to being an intellectual Kshatriya. There's another one, Krishna Pal. Is there a need to institutionalize ourselves to make an impact? Very good. I think this Krishna Pal Singh has asked the best question. And Krishna Pal Singh ji, I would like the Manjul people to send you a copy of my book and I'll be happy to autograph it, okay? So institutionalization is so important. You know, if you have individual people who are great, and when the guy is dead or gone, it's all scattered, and that energy built is no longer continued because we could not make a parampara. In the traditional times, we had paramparas. Those were institutions. Okay. Now what has happened is when a guru dies or when a thinker dies, the movement started, falls apart, it dissipates, and some other movements start. Because everybody is keen to do jugaad and become his own leader and become his own guru very quickly, beg, borrow, steal, whatever it takes, just go and start your own thing. Religious groups going on, guru groups going on, starting new media channels, starting new intellectual people starting. So we are not able to follow somebody and create an institution, a lineage. Okay. And the West in fact is creating institutions. West created Marxism 150 years after Marx, is vibrant. West created Freudianism, feminism, postmodernism, so many schools of thought they've created. Now, we haven't created, we idolize the founder. We idolize Vivekanand. But where is the Vivekanand school of thought being taught? You know, Deen Dayal Upadhyay, we idolize him. But where is his school of thought, a formal discipline that people can learn? And where is the army of people who can say, okay, I live by that school of thought? Where is the Gandhian school of thought? Even Gandhi, it's more like an icon. You know, but who are the Gandhians? How are they living the Gandhian life today? So this absence of institutionalization is a very serious problem for us. Thank you, all of you. I think my time is over, and I want to say namaste to all of you for listening. I'm here in Princeton, successful so far in fighting the coronavirus infections. We are staying at home for the last 6 weeks. New York is the epicenter of the whole world of this problem, which originated in China. And New Jersey, where I live, is the second largest state with this number of cases. So it's surrounded by, we are surrounded by that, but we are staying at home. I have been using this as an opportunity to catch up with my writing. So I'm getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning and writing my books. And so hopefully when all this is over, I'll be coming to India to launch some very exciting books, several of them in 2020, I hope to be able to launch. Thank you so much and namaste. Thank you for watching. You can subscribe here and also hit the bell icon to make sure you get notified. To donate, please click this button.